Awesome. So hello, everybody. My name is Andrei Cotaie, and together with my colleague, Tiberiu Boros, we're going to have a short and fun discussion regarding a tool we recently open sourced. So a couple of words about us. We are Adobe Security Intelligence Team. We are a part of the Security Coordination Center in Adobe, the team that actually handles incident response. So the purpose of our team is to do data science slash machine learning research oriented into the security field. So we're basically focused mostly on reactive security. And that means you're trying to identify stuff which we cannot detect through conventional ways. In other words, we use the data, the logs, and the security information we gather from Adobe assets in order to identify anomalies and, of course, bad stuff. Cool. So what's OSAS? OSAS stands for One-Stop Anomaly Shop. So OSAS is a machine learning framework, which whole purpose is actually to detect anomalies. The open source project that we just released, and by the way, this is the first place we're actually presenting OSAS, so we're really excited about this. So the whole the framework itself is based on a couple of Adobe's security intelligence team previous work, white papers, some components from some patents we filled, and so on. Now, the goal of OSAS is to make as simple as possible for everybody to experiment with the data they're having, with ways of processing the data and anomaly algorithms, and to find the most balanced combination model for you. Once you have the model, just put it into production and identify your anomalies. But most important, OSAS tries to answer the following question. Why is an anomaly an anomaly? So to understand better anomalies, let's actually go to the next section. So the anomaly principle, anomaly detection principle. I hope you actually like the picture I presented here. So what are anomalies? In theory, it's pretty simple. Anomalies are extremely rare events, simple as pie. How? That's a little bit more complex. So there are some well-known anomaly detection algorithms like local outlier factor, reconstruction error, isolation forest, clustering, and so on. Now, the question is actually, the problem is how do you process the data to feed that data into those models? So pretty often we generate anomalies in different projects, and those anomalies get to the security experts in our team, right? And they come back and they ask us, like, why is this an anomaly? And if we tell them, well, those are extremely rare events, they're not that happy, right? Like, they want something more concrete, more actionable upon. So coming back to the image we're having, like if I would ask you what's the anomaly, you're going to come pretty fast and going to say, like, the brown egg is the anomaly. And most likely you're right. I mean, that's definitely an outlier there, right? But if you look at the picture, some eggs actually do not wear masks, some have different behaviors, and so on. So the anomaly, the way you actually prepare your data, it's targeting what kind of anomalies you're actually going to detect. So let's do this. Let's take all the eggs and say a couple of words about them. Like, do a short description about them. So the brown egg, it's brown, it has thick eyebrows. I have a couple of eggs there which are actually appear to be in love. I definitely have an egg there who has like some eye issues and might require surgery. And I do have an egg somewhere in the middle who is crying, like looks really desperate. So I ask you again, like, what's my anomaly? Depending on what you're targeting, that's the anomaly. So that's actually what OSAS is trying to do. So One-Stop Anomaly Shop is going to try to describe all the events you have on a data set with tags. Some are pre-computed, some are actually generated based on the expert knowledge. It's going to tell a story about each observation and then feed that story to the anomaly algorithms and then identify the anomalies. Now, so that story is actually described by us by labels. We generate labels. So generating the labels actually becomes the entire magic of OSAS. Now, I'm going to let Tiberiu discuss a little bit more about how we generate the tags and what's their impact on the data.
Okay, so thank you, Andrei. So it's very important to say that when we design OSAS, we especially had in mind being able to process semi-structured log data And we're referring to whatever can be found in, I don't know, access logs or error logs from Apache or Tomcat, user logins, Hubble data, and so on. Right. This information is semi-structured because, I mean, you can infer a couple of attributes from it. For instance, I mean, from Apache, you can look at the logs and you can extract the timestamp, the IP address, the URL, the client try to access, the response code, and so on. And one very important aspect about this type of data is that it contains many attributes with unbound values. For instance, the IP address is, I mean, it's unbound. It has a really large, you know, value space. It can be, it can have a lot of combinations from all over the world. The URL also can include some components that are dynamic, such as IDs, parameters, and so on. And the thing about this type of attributes is that they actually generate something which is called a large feature space. I mean, by comparison, the number of examples that you can have in a manageable data set, which can be, I don't know, downloaded, processed using machine learning, is relatively small. So these two factors combined generate something that is called data sparsity, which is actually an unwanted effect for machine learning algorithms, which, you know, renders them to overfit the training data and makes them generalize poorly on previously unseen examples. So the idea is that, I mean, to cope with this, OSAS reduces the large feature space by employing a two-step approach. First, it does tagging on a raw data set. And then it runs the anomaly detection algorithms. And the tagging is done by using a couple of predefined recipes for various attribute types and specific field types. And also it is able to handle freeform text data. It's able to extract advanced features by combining different tags. So we have, if we move to the next slide, we are going to talk about the tags that OSAS is generating on the data. So the first set of tags, we call those simple tags. It's basically composed of multinomial fields, numerical fields, and field combiners. Multinomial fields are fields that take discrete values. So you can, the process name, it's probably a discrete value field, right? Because you have a limited set of processes that will usually run in your environment, right? What else? The parent process name, the username is probably in production environment is going to be from a limited set of possible value combinations. So in order to detect them, to detect this type of attributes, we count all the unique values inside the training data, and we expect to have less than 10% unique values for a specific attribute. If you have, we have that, we consider that to be a discrete or a multinomial field. And just to have an idea, I mean, when we tested on our data sets, basically we got like a 1% number of unique values for a multinomial field, and we had a huge gap, and everything that was like freeform text or numerical fields and so on had 40% plus. So 10% is like a good enough threshold to capture whatever can be regarded as a multinomial field. In order to label this type of attributes, we build a statistical distribution of the values, and we assign the labels based on the rarity or the probability of seeing an attribute with a specific value, right? And you have like fine-grained generation of attributes. So let's say you have a process name, right? There's the attribute and it contains processes. If it's, you see that process a lot, it's not going to generate a label. If you see it, less frequent is going to say, rare process name value. If it's you never seen it or you have seen it very few times, it's going to say either extremely rare process name or previously unseen process name, which is a special tag that we assign for multinomial fields whenever we encounter values that we have not previously seen. Now, this model actually requires pre-training, and it is stored with our model. Next, we have numerical fields. We do the detection in a similar manner. So we count all the unique attribute values. We expect to have more than 10% values. All of them have to be floating point numbers or special value of none. And whenever you have less more than 10% unique values, we say that and they are numerical, we say that that's a numerical field. Also, if you have a numerical values inside the field and you get less than 10% unique values, they are going to be treated as multinomial fields, right? So you have something like an instance ID, and you only have like 10 values for a 1 million corpus of examples, they are going to be treated as discrete values. So in order to label them, we compute the mean and the standard deviation for all the observed values, and we assign labels based on the Z rule or the Gaussian probability of a value, being part of that all the observations. Again, the model requires training and it is stored with our data. Finally, from the simple field generators, we have the field combiners. So basically what the field combiners do, they try to generate some more generic or abstract features by combining multinomial fields together. So you might have something like the process and parents process combined, or username and process combined. And whenever you have something like Apache running a Netcat or a SSH, it's probably going to say that you have a really rare process parent process value in your data set. The labels are assigned similarly to those of multinomial fields, and also the model requires training and it is stored. Now, if we move to the next slide, we have the more advanced field types. So we have text fields. Text fields are actually, they fail the test for multinomial fields. They are not numerical. They are freeform text. So it can be anything from, URLs, in case your website takes a lot of parameters, or they can be, some type of comments, errors, something that's really unbound and can look like, natural language in some way. So in order to label this type of attribute, we compute something which is called a language model. And for this, we use two strategies. The language models are really common in natural language processing. You can build them using, at character level. So you can have, windows of 3 to 5 characters and build a language model using that. Or you can do some simple tokenization, remove all the special characters and split over spaces. In that case, usually the size of the n-grams, it's smaller, it's not 3 to 5 like the characters, you go from 2 to 3, 2 to 4 or something like that. So based on the language model, for every attribute value inside our data set, we compute something which is called perplexity. Or how perplex is the model when it sees a previously unseen character string, right? And based on these values for the entire data set, again, we compute the mean and the standard deviation. And whenever we process the new data, we compute this value. And again, we assign numbers based on the mean and standard deviation, similarly to the way we do for numerical fields. This model also requires training and it is stored. And finally, we have another field generator type. It's called expert knowledge field generator, and it tries to enable human experts input their knowledge into the model. So this type of label generator takes a configuration file, it looks for specific keywords or specific regular expressions, and assigns label based on the way it matches the data. For instance, you can have a list of known application in your Linux environment. You can have some keywords like interesting paths like dev TCP, and whenever it matches the data, it will generate a label. So this model does not require any training because it is statically built, and it does not require to be stored with the model. Finally, if we move forward, we're going to see that OSAS actually provides out of the box support for 4 anomaly detection algorithms. So we have isolation forest, local outlier factor, and statistical SVD based anomaly detection and statistical n-gram anomalies. Now, the important thing is that we apply those anomaly detection algorithms on the labels that we generate in the previous step. They don't see the raw data. They don't look at attribute values. They just look at the tags that OSS is doing before the data is fed into those algorithms. And the first three are actually part of scikit-learn. If you want to know about the way they work and how they establish something is an anomaly or not, you can go ahead and read the documentation and maybe the white papers associated with this documentation. The last one, the statistical engram anomaly, is something that we built especially for OSAS. What it does, it basically computes all the possible combinations of two and three tags that we generate previously, and it computes the probability of observing those tags together. Now, based on this probability, we compute a negative log likelihood, and whenever you see a new example, we build all the possible tag combinations, and we sum over the negative log likelihood, which is basically becomes a rarity score for that observation. So in a nutshell, and last slide, OSAS has three main modules. On the left side, we have the data acquisition module, which uses a CM4 runtime and a statically compiled data set for training. The middle section is called the labeling or data grooming module, and it applies labels for the observations in your data set, the labels we talked about earlier. And finally, the right section is the scoring module, which uses one of the four anomaly scoring strategies to assign scores to the examples. And during the training, we use a static data set, a frozen data set, you might call it, to compute statistics and build the language models, compute the occurrences of attribute values and so on, learn how to assign labels. We label the entire training data set. And then we feed this data to the scoring strategies, whatever you choose. And then at runtime, we just apply all the three elements of the pipeline and finally get our events with associated event anomaly scores. So I'm going to let Andrei take over from here.
Cool. Okay, so Tiberiu already had a discussion regarding the technical stuff that's actually composing OSS. So let's have a short and fun POC. So basically, we're going to do three stuff. We are going to make OSS up and running because OSS is a Docker, it runs on a Docker container. It has a web interface and also has an Elasticsearch. You're going to see really fast. We're going to run OSS on its default configuration of data set, and then we're going to customize an OSS to run on the same data set and compare the results between the default one and the customized one. Okay, so let's get OSS up and running. So starting from our Git page, basically you can run OSS in a couple of ways. You can take the pre-compiled Docker image, which you have there, and we have the commands, or you can build it locally, or if you want, you can use directly the OSS scripts without the Elasticsearch integration and the Docker. There is a chance you might want to do that for production. Now, this is my working folder. Basically, here I have just one folder. I have a data set. I constructed a data set. I mean, I know what data is inside it, and I basically added some malicious commands in it so we can have what to show for this example. Now, all the Docker commands are on Git. I pulled the last image, already had it. And you run the Docker command. So the Docker command has a couple of interesting parameters. First, we have to expose the port for the OSAS web interface. As I mentioned, OSAS has a web interface. Then you have to expose the port for the Elasticsearch Kibana, because they're going to have this data and some interesting dashboards. And then you have to map a folder from your machine with the Docker so you can actually share data sets, get results, and get the model that you train and so on. Now, we're going to execute the command. It's going to go pretty smooth. Starting all the services, the OSAS web interface, the Kibana, and everything. Now, if we go here and we are lazy, we also added here the links. So we have the links for OSAS and we have the link for Kibana. So regarding the OSAS, the main thing we actually expose on our Git, we have a shell in the browser. Basically, we're giving you a full access shell to the Docker instance via browser, so you don't have to SSH in, and you can run all the OSS commands from here. So we actually provide a little more. OSS has multiple web pages. We don't really talk about them on the Git page because some of them are under construction, or most likely some of the pages are working, but they did not provide a progress bar when you're running stuff. But from the web interface, you can basically have the console, or you can run the full pipeline with just one click, or you can customize the entire full pipeline on that page. For example, with this one, you select the data set and it automatically goes. This one permits you to do configuration step by step. Cool. Okay. So the Elasticsearch is actually a default installation of Elasticsearch. It only has some dashboards that we specially created for OSS, and they're going to be populated when you're actually going to push data. That's going to happen automatically, and you're going to see the web interface is pretty useful. Now, OSS, running OSS is actually composed of three parts. The first one is to generate an autoconfig. So the auto-configuration scope is to actually look at the dataset, identifies what columns, what features you have, what types of features there are, and then make recommendation how you want to process the data and what features actually to combine. And it's actually going to map everything that Tiberiu said before. You have multinomial fields, combiners. You do not have in the default configuration enabled the expert knowledge ones. Okay, now. Second step is train the pipeline. You basically have a data set, you have a configuration file, you train your model, right? And your model is going to contain the main model anomaly algorithm and also the model to execute the data processing. And finally, you run your model. So basically, you run your model on the data set you train, or you run your model on some data you acquire. Like you can train on the last 3 months and run the model on data today. As long as the data has the same schema, it's working. Now, this is all OSS in a glance. It takes just a couple of seconds to get it up and running. And it's actually pretty simple to do that. Okay, going further, let's run a default OSS step by step from the command line. So starting a fresh new OSS, going in the command line, and let's actually make sure that what I mapped from my local machine is actually available in the Docker instance. And great, I have the data set here. So we're going to run the autoconfig file. So the autoconfig file, again, is going to look at your data set. It's going to identify what features you have. It's going to make recommendation how to process that and what combination to max to do. By default, the autoconfig file contains also the anomaly algorithm that's going to be used. By default, it's going to be statistical engram. If you want anything else, you have to manually change that algorithm. Okay, so it takes as an input the data set, and as an output, it's going to have a configuration file, which we're going to create really fast. It's going to go really fast. The data set is pretty small. It has 5,000 observations. So what we can do now really fast, we can look at the configuration file that we just created, right? So it's going to be in the same folder where I have data set. That was my choice. And you can see all the labels there. Again, if you look at the end, you're going to see the anomaly scoring. And the anomaly scoring is statistical engram. That's the one we serve by default. Cool. Now, first step is the second step is let's train the model. So to train the model, we have the train pipeline command, which takes as an input parameter the data set, the configuration file, and as an output parameter is going to be the model itself. Once you generate this model, you can take it from here and move it wherever you think in production. So OSS can be a research platform, but it can also be used in production once you have a good model, which you're happy with. Now, the model itself is going to contain the anomaly algorithm model, but also the models for all the field processing units, right? In the future, we should actually add also the configuration file to the model. It seems like a smart move. Not sure why we haven't done that so far. Running the pipeline, it's really fast, especially it's a small data set. Building the model also takes just a couple of seconds. And voila, that's it. We have a model now. Now, to run the model, you have the function run model, which is similar to train model. Takes more or less the same parameters. It's just going to add also the file where we want to store results. Running the model does the following thing. You're going to add tags to your data set, and you are going to add a score to your data set. So each observation is going to have a tag and a score. We do not prune data. We leave you the entire data. We just tag it and score it. And you're going to see that really fast when you're actually going to move to the Elasticsearch. Again, going real fast, you're also going to have the results on disk. You can basically take the results and open it with Excel, numbers, pandas. It's your choice. Cool. Okay, so let's go to the Elasticsearch. It's a default installation with admin, and you can see I was really nervous. I had a lot of typos during this recording. Okay, opening it. No, I'm not going to save the last pass. No, I'm sure I don't want to save it. It almost tricked me there. And I'm going to go to the dashboard. The dashboard that I mentioned before, right? So now the dashboard is pre-populated and it has like a lot of information. The number of observations I have in my data set and the algorithm I have been using. Great, that's useful information. Now, each anomaly algorithm is going to generate a score. So we score all observations. The theory goes like that. The closer the score is to zero, the more non-malicious slash interesting it is. The further the score from zero, the most interesting the anomaly is. So we are targeting those which have a big score. Also, from a label perspective, really interesting, we computed 43 unique labels by using the unique OSAS implementation. So those are all statistical data science labels. So another one I really like is this histogram score. So basically, I'm doing a histogram on the score of my observation. And it's really interesting why, because you can see really fast that most of my elements, almost 4,000 of them, are concentrated around zero. So they're not interesting. So I can make really fast a filter and I say, okay, give me everything that's greater than 1,000. And then we have some pieces of LAMS where we have the rest of the data, right? So it's really nice from a visualization perspective because we do understand what our anomalies are things with big scores, right? Which are not in the center. We also have in the dashboard like the most common labels and the rarest labels. And you can see like the command extreme flexibility, like that's definitely the rarest one. And we also show what are the anomaly elements with the highest score. And you do not show the observation itself, we just showed actually their labels. And that's the bigger score. Now, let's actually move and look at the data itself. So if we go to discover, we have all the data, and I already said that we can use a hard threshold to select what are the interesting anomalies, right? So I'm just going to say score, give me everything that's actually greater than 1000. Okay, cool. And it's going to run really fast. Again, it's a small data set. Next, what we can do, we can actually make it look as a table, right? So we'll select the score, select the command line. Okay, now sort it descending. And well, so descending, I said, and here we are. And to be honest, I was disappointed about these results. Definitely the anomalies I inserted in my data set are in the top 1000 elements, but they're not in the top 10. They're not in the top 100. And my expectation was for them to be up there high. Like I, as a security researcher, I don't want to waste time in clicking around the data. I want to have the important thing there, up there. And it doesn't happen here. Like you definitely saw a couple of malicious stuff. I'm definitely going to stop somewhere there, but they're not there in top. And that makes perfect sense because OSAS is an anomaly detection tool. It's not a malicious detection tool. But we're going to show you really fast how in just a couple of minutes you can transform OSAS from an anomaly detection into a security detection tool. So let's customize OSAS in just a couple of minutes and see how it behaves compared to the default installation one. Okay, same page as before, brand new Docker installation. I'm going to use this time the web interface because I already marketed it, right? So it's going to do the same thing as the autoconfig. I'm going to select my data set. I'm going to give it a name and I'm going to click submit and it's going to actually to create an autoconfig like the one we saw before. Now, I want to process a little the autoconfig. So first thing, select the configuration file in case I have too many. And I have all the features and all the combination now here. And really important, I have here the anomaly detection algorithm that I'm going to use. So this is the list, and I'm going to select the local outlier factor. So the reason I'm doing this, to be honest, the first time I started with machine learning, this was the first algorithm I ever used. So I'm kind of emotional about the local outlier factor. Doesn't mean it's better than the others. It's just my personal choice. So I select that and I'm going to take out some of the fields I know did not provide value, like that field and some combination regarding that field. And I have a couple of timestamps at the end. I know they do not provide value because I extracted the data, so I know it's good or bad. Cool. I'm going to take those out and I'm going to submit it. And now I also have the option to manually edit the configuration file. So remember Tiberiu spoke about expert knowledge, and that comes in two forms, keyword labels or regex. So I'm going to do the keyword label one, and I'm going to apply it on the field name command, because that's the command. In this case, I said the command is name command, in other name, it could be called process. So I'm going to add a list of commands. I know they can be used in Linux environments for administrators and battlers. It's a huge list of commands, which most of you actually have used them. And you know, attackers or living off the land are actually using them. And they're going to provide a great, a nice value better there. So I'm just going to put that list there. I know I'm not going to touch the regex for this one. And that's my new configuration file. Easy as pie. I promise you it takes 2 minutes. It took only 2 minutes. Cool. Now that I have the new configuration file with expert knowledge, I'm going to go back to the command line. And I'm actually going to run the last 2 steps from command line. So I have the new configuration file. It's called Taylor now, my personal choice there. And I'm going to run again the train pipeline. So train pipeline is going to train the model with the new configuration file. It's going to use as an input the data set, the configuration file, and it's going to have as an output the model itself. Again, the model is going to contain the anomaly detection algorithm and all the feature processing components there. So that's everything you're going to need. Like everything is stuck in that model file that we're going to generate really fast. So this model actually contains less label generators because we have deselected quite a few. I think we deselected like 7 or 8 of them, but we added in the expert knowledge one. Okay. Run it. It's not going to take that so long. It's basically faster than the other one. I just cut a couple of seconds from the previous one. It's going to go to the model. The model is actually also behaving really fast. Just as a note, the local outlier factor does not have a progress bar. That's the default version that you get from scikit-learn. When you run the pipeline, is the same thing. It doesn't have a progress bar. But again, for our data set, which only 5,000 observations, is going to go really fast and really smooth. So run pipeline, and I'm basically going to offer it as an output, the file where I want to store my data set with labels and with scores. And it's going to go really fast at the end of this command. If you're running in a Docker instance, automatically it's going to push the data to the Docker instance that it's built there. So that's how we have all the data available there. And the part to push the data to the Elasticsearch actually goes pretty fast. It is up to 1 million entries, and it takes under 1 minute to push so much data. Okay. Let's go again to the dashboards and see how the dashboard looks now. So same number of observation, new anomaly detection algorithm. Great, that's what I wanted. And let's look a little at the anomalies. So really interesting, I have 125 labels now. I have three times more labels than previously. And that's because of the expert knowledge component that we added. Now, the score is different because each anomaly detection algorithm behaves a little different. Now the score is closer to 0. And one really interesting thing you have to see, it's actually the score histogram. So do you remember the previous score histogram that it has some humps, like after the big spike, you had some small humps? You don't have that anymore. And if you look at the data around 0, most of all my observations are there, right? So like my anomalies are scarce and they have huge numbers. So definitely I see an improvement just from looking at this diagram, right? So I don't know what's 99% of the data, it's actually there. Okay, cool. Regarding the other features, we have more or less the same information. We have what are the Redis labels. And you can see now that I have new labels. I have a command keyword, change config, CPU limit, cut, and stuff like that. Like those something things I didn't saw before. And I was from the rarest most common labels, you can see I have less common labels because we took out some which we know they're not providing value. And the same thing, what are the top anomalies and what are the commands there? And you can see command keyword echo, command keyword password, change strace and things like that. So the expert knowledge is now a part of the labels. Okay, so let's look at the anomalies this time. I'm not going to use a threshold anymore. I'm just going to make a table. So I'm going to add the score. I'm going to add the command, and let's actually also add the labels. And let's just sort them descending and see what we got. Okay, sorting descending. And well, surprise, surprise. I do have the interesting stuff up there really fast. Netcat, Ruby. I do have some anomalies which they have nothing to do with the security perspective. But still, like all my malicious stuff is up here in top 10, top 100. I have all the interesting stuff I want, right? So we basically took OSS and we transformed it from anomaly detection algorithm into a security detection platform. Really fast, just 2 minutes, with just some command lines specific to living off the land. Nothing intelligent there. Like the expert knowledge part is just a couple of words I added to a list. Now, we definitely detect this experiment targeting Linux environment and Linux commands. But you can do this experiment for Windows. You can do this experiment as a network IDS if you want, or you can do this for HTTP logs, right? Like trying to detect SQL injection, path traversal, or the other kind of attacks or exploits there. So OSS can be used really easy, really fast in different kind of situations. And again, the main thing is you can really easily customize it for what you need. Just a couple of steps, not a lot of research, and you can experiment with all the features and all the things we have.
Okay, so as Andrei said, one of the key takeaways is that OSS is really fast and it allows you to expand your data. One or two very important tips whenever using OSS. So look over the data, try to remove everything that you know is out of place and will not bring any value. Try to build advanced feature sets by combining multiple fields, but I mean, do it incrementally. Don't just throw everything in. Do it step by step. Look at the initial autoconfig file, remove unnecessary stuff, run it, look at if you get your anomalies wherever you want them, then try to add some, expert knowledge, try to combine more fields and so on. Also, there's no one size fits all anomaly scoring algorithm, so you should experiment with all four, scoring strategies that OSS provides, in order to find the optimal formula for your data set. And finally, if we move to the next slide, we really want to ask you something. If you like OSS, if you like the presentation, could you give us a star?
Give us a star. Okay, that was mostly from our side. If you guys have any questions, if not, thank you very much for attending this. And again, give us one star or two.